this is a song that Dad in particular really likes. Draw me close to all you.
All right.
Thank you. Do me fa sol la ti do. Thank you, Hope. Never let me go. You're my heart's desire. Bring me close to you. Ooh, 'cause I've seen you work in others, and I know it's working in me. Said I see. Kids, Waldo's all gone all over the place. He's traveling here. That's what this message is about. What's Jesus doing? And we're going to preface on, the pastor gave a beautiful message about Jesus dying on the cross. Amen?
Amen.
How Jesus died for our sins. He died for our transgressions. So I love the part, not only did he die for our sins, but he died for our transgressions. Amen. What is that talking about? He died only for the sins you committed, but he died for the sins that others committed before you got here.
Amen.
So Jesus not only died for what you're about to do, he died for the things that were done to you.
Amen.
Isn't Jesus good? Give y'all Jesus a hand clap. Amen.
Thank you, Jesus.
And the sacrifice that Jesus did for us, it said he sacrificed one time. Because if you do your research in the Old Testament, they had to sacrifice a lamb every year. It had to be a perfect lamb with no blemish. But when John, we fast forward to the future in the book of John, it says John the Baptist saw Jesus coming. He says, behold, the Lamb of God,
amen,
who taketh away the sins of the world. Not just your sin,
amen,
but the sin of the nations.
When
it says the sin of the world, is talking about ethnic groups.
Thank you, Jesus.
Amen. The sin of ethnic groups.
Thank you,
the Jesus that you serve is the Jesus that loves all ethnic groups.
Amen.
So we're going to take off with, after Jesus died and he came back to life again, what did Jesus do? I mean, did he come just to die for our sins, which is awesome? Everybody said, if he didn't do anything else,
if he didn't do anything else,
he's done more than enough.
He's done more than enough.
Because the Jesus that you serve, he is the great I am.
Amen.
Amen. And what's so cool is when he died upon the cross, as I said earlier, he died for future, past, and present sins.
Amen.
He got it all covered in one time.
Amen.
Because you serve a God who exists in multiple time zones. Amen.
Amen.
He thought of you before you came.
Amen.
So we're going to turn to the book of Acts. I don't know if this might be a mini-series or not, so it just depends. Amen.
Amen.
It's a question I have. What's Jesus doing now? And how you're going to figure that out is, you got to go to the Bible. I was on Facebook with a buddy of mine, and I love it when people Facebook me and ask me questions about the Bible, because what's so cool about the Bible is if you ask a question, the Bible always answers it. And like I told him in my response, sometimes when the Bible answers your question, it sometimes will give you a response you don't want to hear.
That's right.
Amen.
Amen.
See, the truth I love about Jesus is he comes with truth and grace. So he has this unique ability to tell you what you don't want to hear, but yet he'll tell you because he loves you.
Amen.
And he'll do it in such a way to where even if you got offended, you're not getting offended because of how he said it. You get offended because it's pricking your conscience.
Amen.
Amen. So that's what's going on in our country. Where I was talking to another buddy of mine is that there's not enough of the truth being preached
Amen.
In the podiums.
Amen.
God is not interested in just telling you what you want to hear.
That's right.
He wants to tell you something to keep you out of hell. Amen.
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 Amen. So let's look into the book of Acts, because God loves everybody.
Amen.
What I love about God, you talk a little bit more about him, is Jesus is the only person that you'll ever hear in history who was God made in the flesh, who wanted to become like us. As the book of Romans said, he died for us when we were enemies.
Amen.
So think about this. How did God decide to encounter his enemy, the human race? Think about that. The very people he created became his enemy.
Amen.
And the devil thought he won. But look at the devil knew it was still in the wheel.
Amen.
Isn't that something? Give God a praise.
Praise the Lord.
It was still in the wheel. Amen. This ain't part of my message. I just didn't have to talk about it. God loved you so much that even when we were his enemies, he said, you know what I'm going to do? I'm not going to fight y'all the way you want me to fight you. Because that's what people do. They want you to come at them the way you come
Amen.
At them. God said, no, I'm God all by myself.
All right.
I'm going to do something that even the enemy didn't expect. He gave him a hint in the book of Genesis, the third chapter. After when the devil fooled Adam and Eve to eat of the fruit, which is disobedience, the fruit of disobedience. The power wasn't in the fruit, the power is in the words.
Amen.
Well, God told them, if you eat of this fruit, you'll surely die. And the devil just knew, oh, that means you'll be separated from God. He knew what death meant.
Uh-huh.
You'll be separated. And just when he thought it was over, the great I am looked at Eve and said, I'm going to bring a seed from you. And he will bruise the head of the enemy. God let the human race know up front, you are not my enemies.
Amen.
You may think that I'm your enemy, but your enemy is the devil.
Amen.
And I'm going to use you to bring the seed to bruise the devil.
Amen.
And his big head. And he looked at the devil and said, all you're going to do to the seed is bruise his heel. How come his heel was bruised? Because the seed was stepping on the head of the serpent.
Well, praise him.
Because the Bible says you will walk upon serpents and scorpions. And over all the powers of the enemy. So we're going to figure out who this seed was. It's Jesus.
Amen.
And what happened was God said, let me show you how I fight the human race. I'm not going to fight you with spears and swords. First off, I'm not going to fight you.
Amen.
I'm going to become one of you. Think about that.
Uh-huh.
He became the very people who was fighting him.
Uh-huh.
And he came in the form of a seed. And he said, to make sure that this seed is not infected, he's going to look like you.
Amen.
But the person who's going to give him his genetic code is me. So I'm going to cause Mary to get pregnant without the agency of a man, because sin apparently passes from a father to son and daughter, not to the mother.
Uh-huh.
Isn't that interesting? The question you should ask is, Chris, why is that so? Say it, y'all.
Chris, why is that so?
I'm so glad you asked, because Adam was the God of this world,
uh-huh.
not Eve. She became a cool authority carrier, but she wasn't the God of this world. Because think about it, no, survival doesn't talk about Eve as the God of this world. It refers to Adam as the first Adam.
Amen.
She was not the first Adam. Think about that. So God didn't blame women for where we are. He blamed the man, because that's where the genetic code is passed through.
Amen.
Think about that. And what happened was, when he sent Jesus, he said, now, since sin passes through the seed of a man, because women don't give seeds, because even genetically, if you study, it says it is the male who determines the gender.
Amen.
Not the mom. Mm-hmm. So that's how come he's like, God said, I need to find a way to bring my son into existence of a human body, but uh-huh. yet not be infected with sin. So God was created, he said, since I'm God, since I created man out of dirt.
Amen.
Think about that. He created man out of dirt. He said, that's easy. I'm going to use woman, marry the woman, and I'm going to cause a sperm and an egg to be created within her.
Wait.
Now all I'm going to do is, he's going to get his human body from her, because apparently he's going to look like her people.
Uh-huh.
Amen.
Amen.
But his genetic code, his spirituality,
well, praise him.
His non-sin gene comes from the Heavenly Father
well,
himself.
And nobody do that.
So that's how come Jesus can stand up in front of us and say, I am 100% God, but yet I'm 100% man.
Amen.
Give God a praise.
Praise the Lord.
Amen. Because there's a question that my generation and younger are asking. Why did Jesus even come? This is like part of my message. Good Lord, I guess it's time to preach. It's a sad shame in our country that most people don't know why Jesus came. Amen. Jesus didn't come to give us a better job, though he will. Jesus didn't come for us to get our bodies healed, which he will.
Amen.
He looked at your spirit.
Amen.
What good is it to be wealthy and go to hell?
Amen.
He wants to save your spirit.
Amen.
And get this. No one doesn't want to save your spirit. He wants to save your body.
Amen.
Isn't God good?
Yes, he is.
So if you don't like this body you got, just wait around just a little while longer. Because if you die, he'll give you a better body.
Amen.
If you're short, he might make you tall.
Well.
Glory to God. If you're kinky, he might make it straight.
Well.
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord. Talk about hair. So let's look over to the book of Acts. Amen. He's going to talk about what happened to Jesus. What's Jesus doing? So, give you history. The book of Acts is written by Dr. Luke. Dr. Luke is one of the Greek people who were saved under Paul's ministry. And if you study the book of John, book of Luke, excuse me, that is also part one of the book of Acts. Because Dr. Luke wrote the book of Luke. And he talked about how he interviewed, in the book of Luke, he talked about how he interviewed people in Jesus' day. So all this came as a part two of the book of Luke. So Luke actually interviewed Mary, the mother of Jesus. He interviewed the disciples. He interviewed all kinds of people who were alive during Jesus' day. That's how he knew all this information. So think of the book of Acts as part two of book of Luke. Amen?
Amen.
So he's writing to, I'm calling Theo. I can't pronounce his name too well. Yeah, book of Acts, the first chapter, first verse. The former treatise have I made, O Theo, of all that Jesus began to both do and teach, until the day in which he was taken up, which is talking about when he went to heaven, after that he through the Holy Spirit had given commandments unto the apostles whom he had chosen, to whom also he showed himself alive after his passion by many infallible proofs, being seen of them for 40 days. So apparently when Jesus died and came back to life, he didn't just go straight to heaven and just had a cup of coffee, cross his legs, and said, it's done. He stayed on earth for 40 days, for a month and 10 days,
mm-hmm.
to show his disciples, I'm really alive.
Amen.
Because think about it. They saw him whooped. They saw him brutally murdered on the cross, mm-hmm. and yet he's walking around. He had signs. If you talk about the book of Mark, Luke, and John, it showed he still has the holes in his hands. He could have healed himself, but he didn't. Because a real champion likes to show you his war wounds.
Amen.
He wants to remind the human race, I am he who was dead, but I am alive forevermore.
Praise the Lord.
That's his infallible proofs. Amen?
Amen.
And speaking of things pertaining to the kingdom of God, which is how he does what he does. So every time you see the kingdom of God, it talks about how he does what he does. Amen? Amen. Everybody say how he does.
How he does.
What he does.
What he does.
So for those of you who are black, or African American, whatever you want to call ourselves now, those of you who are Hispanic, those of you who are of any ethnic group in certain countries to where it's, you're looked upon as minorities, you're trying to figure out how am I going to get through, you need to do what he does. Because if you get into the kingdom of God, God will give you access to do the things that the majority can do.
Amen.
Amen. He will put you in places that people are trying to figure out, how did you get there?
Amen. Amen.
And you're like, I know you didn't get that through affirmative action. No, you got there through the key access called the
Amen.
Kingdom of God.
Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Those of you who are white, who are in all black situations. Some of us don't think about it this way. It takes faith to be in an all black environment.
Amen.
God will give you the kingdom of God.
Praise
to where
Lord.
You will be able to walk with authority. Okay. Amen. What I'm trying to tell you is the God that I serve is no respecter of persons.
Amen.
He is not for black. He is not for white. He's
Amen.
For right. Amen.
Amen.
So you look on, it says, and being assembled together with them, which is the disciples, he commanded them that they should not leave from Jerusalem, but wait for the promise of the Father, which says he, you have heard of me. For John truly baptized with water, but you shall be baptized with the Holy Ghost not many days hence. When they therefore came together, they asked of him, saying, Lord, will you also restore again the kingdom to Israel? Because remember, he's talking about the kingdom. So they assume he's talking about he's going to come back. He's going to take over the Romans and overthrow them and rule of them with an iron rod, because that's what he promised in the book of Psalms, if you recall. But look how he responds back. See, the same thing's happening. Let me just pull this pull here. Some people want Jesus to come back and kill all the white people. I'm just going to be real. Isn't that terrible?
Amen.
Some people want Jesus to come back and kill all the black people.
Mm-hmm.
Jesus, they want Jesus to come back and destroy all the terrorists. That's not why he came the first time around.
Amen.
He came, the Bible says, so that none should perish.
Amen.
Jesus' revolution is not like human revolution.
That's right.
How he decides to revolutionize the world is not through money.
Amen.
It's not through politics. He wants to change it one heart at a time.
Amen.
Because the Bible says in the book of Ezekiel that I will put my law in their hearts.
Uh-huh.
And I will walk inside of them. He's like, if I can ever get you to understand that the kingdom of God is the law,
uh-huh.
and that it will come in your heart, it will cause you not to do all the crazy sinning we've been doing.
Amen.
I don't have to tell you the thou shalt nots, because the thou shalt nots are within you.
Amen.
Isn't that something?
Amen.
So this is how Jesus responds back. He says in the seventh verse, it is not for you to know the times, nor the seasons, which the Father has put in his own power. What he says is, it's none of your business about God's timetable. But he says, you shall receive power. I love what Jesus does. You ask him a question. I told you that. If you ask him a question, he'll sometimes answer you, but you may not like the answer.
Amen.
He has a one-track mind. He said, I have 40 days to get y'all ready for my succession plan. This is a revelation that I've noticed. Jesus is showing us, remember in the book of Proverbs, it says how a good man, a godly man, leaves an inheritance to his family.
Mm-hmm.
What that's talking about is you as a godly man, a godly woman, is not supposed to die until you tell your children what you expected them to do when you're gone. That's why Jesus stayed for 40 days.
Praise the Lord.
Because he's like, I can't leave this earth. He's the only man I ever knew that died. But before he died, he rolled a wheel.
Well.
And when he rolled a wheel, he said, now, this wheel can't be executed until I die. Just like with us.
Amen.
We can't get anything until our parents die. But what's unusually about Jesus is he died. And he stayed in the ground, Bible says, for 3 days and 3 nights. So he let his body stay in the Ramada Inn for 3 days and 3 nights. But then he got up, the Bible says. Let me preach. But he got up! Glory
well,
to God. He got up.
Well.
And what's so cool about it is, when he says, I am the resurrection, he woke himself up. Think about that. Let's just pick a pin there. He woke himself up.
Well. Praise him.
And the Bible says, I was able to wake myself up because I received a commandment from the Father that says I have the authority, even over death, to cause my dead body to come back to life myself.
Praise the Lord.
This is a bad dude we serve, y'all.
Praise
and then he came back. Here's what's so unusual about his will. He came back to make sure they were reading his will.
Amen.
Oh, glory to God. And that's why in the book of Luke, he talked about how he was walking the road of Emmaus. He overheard two of his disciples talking about this man, Jesus. And they couldn't figure out why all these things happened to him. And he got so excited, so he interrupted their discussion. And he was talking with them about the wheel.
Well,
the Bible says, from the books of Genesis to the prophets. And they didn't realize that the contestant of the wheel was making sure they understood the reading. So you fast forward later, and he's spending 40 days expounding on them about the wheel. So Jesus came back to life to make sure his children, his brothers and sisters, understood what kind of inheritance was left to them. Think about that. He would not leave. He would not go to heaven until they understood there's an inheritance. And this is what he says in the 8th verse. This inheritance can't come, he said, until you receive power. When you find out the word power means dunamis, dynamite, authority.
Well.
He's like, people, you ever seen, let's be real, y'all been to some funerals that people crying, and they're not crying because they missed that loved one in the coffin. They heard the wheel. And they didn't have anything, any money left to. People come to wedding for funerals for the stupidest reasons. They're not mourning the person who's in the coffin. They're mourning all the money they didn't get. Well, Jesus is not in the coffin anymore.
Amen.
He got out of the coffin, y'all. And he's leaving us something that's more precious than silver and gold.
Amen.
Because if you could ever get the authority of the believer, it transcends money.
Amen.
How many know that when you get sick in your body, even money can't get you healed?
Amen.
How many know that if you're looking for a husband or wife, even money can't buy you the right person?
Amen.
How many know if you're looking for friends, it can't buy you friends?
Amen.
Though money is good, he'll give that to you, but in its place. He wants to give you something greater than that. He's like, let's get to the source. As Donald Lawrence's song goes, let's get back to Eden.
Well,
he gave me the authority to get back the authority that we once had in Eden.
Amen.
So not only do you have the authority that was once in Eden, you even have it beyond what even the first Adam had. Because the first Adam couldn't tell the devil where to go, but
Amen.
You can.
Amen.
That's a revelation. Did y'all know Adam didn't have the authority to bind the devil? He had the power to resist him, but he didn't have the power to bind him. See, every time when Jesus restores something, or every time God restores something, he not only gives you what you lost, he gives you even more than you lost.
Amen. Amen.
Because the Bible says he commands the enemy who stole from you to give it back sevenfold.
Amen.
Give God a praise. Amen. So not only did the enemy steal our spiritual connection with God, our relationship, he stole our ability to live in this body forever.
Amen.
But in God's perfect will, he's like, no, I'm not going to let man die in this shape. That's why he allowed death to come. So even in the midst of chaos, God caused death to become a blessing. Can you imagine that if you lived forever in this body? Did you know you couldn't get saved? Think about that. If God allowed Adam and Eve to eat of the fruit of the tree of life, they could never be redeemed. Did you know the devil was hoping they would? And God, before that, Adam and Eve even had the chance to get over, the Bible says he encamped a cherubim, an angel, with a big old sword that dared Adam and Eve to come over there. God protected them from themselves because he knew that if they would have ate of the tree of life, they would live forever like the devil in sin. Death is a blessing. Think about that. So the devil didn't understand God's plan.
Amen.
So not only did Jesus come back and stay for 40 days to show them that you have this power, he showed them the body that they're going to get in the future. So not only did Jesus redeem us from the curse of the law, not only did he give us, you know, a spiritual connection back to God, not only did he give us a new spirit, he showed us a glimpse what the body we're going to get. So not only did you become born again in your spirit, you become born again in your flesh. Because Job prophesied and said, I will see God in my flesh. And the Bible, you should ask yourself, Job, how is it possible that you're going to see God in your flesh? He was prophesying about the resurrection.
Well,
did you know the Old and New Testament talks about Jesus in so many ways, it just don't make no sense. We hear people talk about how you're going to come back as this and come back as that. It's the devil's poor attempt to tell you the resurrection is true.
Amen.
Because for there to be an imitation, there has to be the real.
Amen.
Did you know that if Jesus tarries, and then you live to be 100 or 120 years old, and you go to heaven, and what happens is your spirit that's within you leaves.
Amen.
And it goes to heaven or goes to hell, depending on who you make your decision for. Amen?
Amen.
And what happens is, this is not even part of my message, the sinners and the saints get a new body. That's why the Bible says in the book of Revelation, blessed is the ones who partake of the first resurrection. That's the one you want to get on board.
Did
you know Jesus has boarding passes? You want to make sure he calls you on the first time. Because that's the time when, if we tarry, like if I tarry, my grandmother who passed away almost 10, 15 years ago, I know she come back because her body is going to come out of the grave.
Amen.
And unite with her spirit.
Amen.
Coming to heaven.
Praise
and
God.
Unite. And once all that happens, all the saints who died before me, when they unite, all of a sudden when he says, come up. As I go up, my body that you see in front of you instantaneously transcends into a whole other human experience.
Amen.
That's what Jesus was showing them in 40 days. He's teaching them, the kingdom of God is so powerful, y'all, that I'm going to give you this body. A body that can go through walls. A body that can eat right. A body that can hear from God instantaneously. This body that will no longer have evil thoughts. Think about that.
Amen.
He's telling us there's so much he's given us on the cross that we can't even fathom.
Amen.
What he has in store for us. So he says, 8th verse, but you shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost has come upon you, and you shall be witnesses unto me both in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and unto the uttermost parts of the earth. And when he spoke in these things, while they looked, he was taken up, and the cloud received him out of their sight. While they looked steadfastly toward heaven as he went up, behold, two men stood by them in white apparel, saying, ye men of Galilee, why stand you gazing up to heaven? This same Jesus, which is taken up from you into heaven, shall come so likewise as you have seen him in heaven. Now, let me give you a backdrop of what's going on here. The church is doing exactly what the original church did right here. We're still looking up to heaven, waiting for Jesus to come back. Some of us aren't even bothering that. Some of us are so busy trying to make money. Who cares about heaven? Let's bring heaven down here. You know, all kinds of weird things going on. And what the angels, which are the two men that stood by, said, why are you standing here? Looking up, staring at Jesus going up. Do what he told you to do. Go into all the world and preach the gospel.
Amen.
That's the one commandment Jesus gave, his charge. So the question goes back to, it sounds like I'm backpedaling. Chris, this makes no sense. I thought you said, what's Jesus doing? I'm telling you what he's doing. His first commandment is, we need to go into all the world and preach the gospel. In our schools, in our jobs, in our personal lives. All preaching the gospel means proclaim the good news. You proclaim the good news not just in front of a pulpit, you proclaim the good news by just living right.
Amen.
If you just live right, you'll cause people to come to you. So let me show you some scriptures to talk more about what Jesus is doing. If you turn to the book of Job, the 9th chapter, Job asks a question. Let's turn to the book of Job. He's asking a question that a lot of us today, especially sinners, are asking that we need to be prepared for. Because I feel that my job here is to prepare us as a congregation to answer questions that are posed by the secular society. Amen?
Amen.
Job, the 9th chapter, first verse. Job is pleading something. He says, then Joseph answered and said, I know it is so of a truth, but how should man be just with God? If he will contend with him, he cannot answer him one of a thousand. He is wise in heart and mighty in strength, who has hardened himself against him and has prospered, which removes the mountains that they know not, which overturns them in anger, which shakes the earth out of her place and the pillars thereof tremble, which commands the sun and it rises not and seals up the stars, which alone spreads out the heavens and treads upon the waves of the sea, which makes Arcticus, Orion, and Pleiades, and the constellation chambers of the south, which does great things passing finding out, yes, and wonders without number. Lo, he goes by me, and I see him not. He passes on also, and I perceive in that. Behold, he takes away. Who can he hinder him? Who can hinder him? Who will say unto him, what does you? If God would not withdraw his anger and the proud helpers do stoop under him, how much less shall I answer him? Choose out of my words to reason with him. Whom, though I were righteous, yet would I not answer, but I would make supplication to my judge. And if I called, he had answered me. Yet would I not believe that he has hearkened to my voice. Now, I read all this because I'm sure all of you are asking, what does this have anything to do with what you talk about? He's asking, is there a mediator? Who can mediate for me? Who can speak for me in the presence of God? I am so unworthy. I've done so much wrong. Who is in heaven who can mediate on my behalf? Who can mediate for God for me? Glad they answered that question. What's Jesus doing? Everybody say that. What's Jesus doing?
What's Jesus doing?
I don't know about y'all, but if I was in Jesus' shoes, I died up on the cross, came back to life again, chilled here for 40 days, I had my legs crossed, eaten for the last 2,000 years. I'm just being serious. I mean, I've done enough for y'all.
Well,
but that's not the God that we serve. Everybody said, thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
He's still working.
Amen.
Isn't that something?
Amen.
As long as you draw close to him. So let's turn over to the book of Hebrews. It sounds like I'm going nowhere, but I'm going somewhere. Job is asking, is there a mediator? That's what the secular world is asking. Is there somebody who can speak on my behalf? Because if you read the book of Job, nobody was mediating for Job. Do you know this, Ed? Do y'all notice that?
Amen.
He had no human beings interceding for him. There was no God-man in heaven who was interceding for him. Amen?
Amen.
So let's turn to the book of Hebrews, the 7th chapter. And I'm going to skip, so then we're running short of time here. See if I get to the right spot I want to show you. Here we go. So the book of Hebrews, the 7th chapter, and we're going to go to the 17th verse. I love this. This is Paul writing to the Hebrews. He's explaining to them what Jesus is doing right now. For he, Jesus, testifies. Did you know that's what Jesus is doing in heaven? He's testifying. This is something unique I've noticed about Jesus. He never tells us to do something that he hasn't already done.
Amen.
He's asked us to be a witness, did he not?
Amen.
Did you know that one of the things Jesus can write down that he's doing in heaven right now is he's witnessing? Jesus is witnessing in heaven. Chew on that. You got Pastor Tim, like you said a lot, chew on that. Jesus is in heaven witnessing. Who is he witnessing to? He's witnessing to the host of heaven because the last time heaven saw Jesus in heaven, he was in his glorified state. He wasn't a man. He was all 100% unadulterated God. And when he came up, I want you all to use your imagination. Remember in the book of Acts, it talked about how he was going up to heaven. And the disciples were looking up. Well, now I'm in heaven. I'm one of the angels. I'm looking down. Now I'm seeing Jesus coming up. And he looks a little different. A little different. He looks like the enemy. He looks like a man. We haven't seen one of these up here before. There's a man walking up here in heaven. And they're looking at him. And he's showing his hands and he's showing his feet. Use your imagination. And the book, I forgot one of the epistles that said that he led captive up in heaven, showing them openly. I don't have time to show you all this, but when he came up to heaven, what you don't realize is he had a march. All the angelic force were gathered up from one end of the aisle to the other end of the aisle. And he was parading himself that he's come back to heaven. But he has a new ministry. Everybody say he has a new ministry.
He has a new ministry.
And he's testifying. So this is what's happening is the Holy Spirit is pulling back the curtain of what happened after Acts the 1st chapter. And Paul is saying, Jesus testifies and says, thou art a priest forever after the order of Melchizedek. Now who he is, just stick a pin there, he is the Old Testament high priest in the book of Genesis. We don't have time to go there. And The Bible doesn't talk about his mom or dad. It just all of a sudden just shows him. And he's known as the King of Salem. Everybody said the King of Salem.
The King of Salem.
And Salem means peace. He also happens to be the king over today's world known as Jerusalem. He is a foreshadow of Jesus. He's the priest that Abraham came to pay a tithe of what he got over his enemies. When they took all his stuff and they took all his servants and stole Lot, he got them back as a 70-some-odd-year-old man and led an army. A 70-some-odd-year-old man led an army and fought all those young people. Now, you know you're anointed. And he came back and gave God homage and gave tithes to this Melchizedek. That's what this is referring to. 18 verse. For there is verily a disannulling of the commandment going before the weakness and unprofitableness thereof. For the law made nothing perfect, but the bringing in of a better hope did, by which we draw unto God. Insomuch as not without an oath he was made priest. Stop. Jesus, when he came to heaven, God told him, thou art a priest after the order of Melchizedek. Amen?
Amen.
And he says, the law made nothing perfect, but bringing in of a better hope did, by which you should draw unto God human beings. Insomuch as not with an oath, without an oath, he said, I have made you, Jesus, high priest. For those priests were made without an oath, but this was an oath by him that said, the Lord swears and will not repent. Thou art a priest after the order of Melchizedek. 22 verse. But so much was Jesus made a surety of a better testament. Or as John Osteen would say, a better covenant. A testament is a better covenant. And that goes back to what I told you earlier. Jesus is the only man that died and came back to life to make sure we're reading his will correctly. Remember he said, I will send another comforter and he will show you all things. Jesus is so good that one of the things he's done is when he came up to heaven, God crowned him high priest. And one of the roles of the high priest is the high priest intercedes for nation. So what's Jesus doing? Write this down. He is witnessing in heaven. Amen. He's showing the angelic host and all of heaven what man looks like in his glorified state. He's shown this is what man can be, the best that man can be. Amen?
Amen.
Number two, what is Jesus doing right now? He's interceding for us as a high priest. What does a high priest do? He's not just a priest. He's a high priest. There's a reason why I'm harping on this. The Bible says he is the King of kings and he's the Lord of lords, right?
Amen.
And the Bible also said he has made us holy priests. So he is the high priest. He is the chief priest. What does that mean is one of the duties of a priest is the priest intercedes day and night for nations. He's called the church to be holy priests, to intercede for our nation day and night. So what am I saying? The book of Matthew, the 18th chapter and 18 verse through 19 verse, it says, whatsoever you bind on earth, it shall be bound in heaven. Stop there. If I'm stopping something on earth, who's stopping something in heaven? Who is it, class?
Jesus.
Jesus. What's Jesus doing right now? Every time you look at the devil and say, I stop your power in the name of Jesus, instantly when you've done it on the earth, meanwhile in heaven, glory to God.
Praise
the Lord. High priest is looking down and says, now I stop you, devil and demonic forces, in my holy name. That's what he's doing. Give God a praise. Amen.
Glory.
Glory to God. Whatever you stop on earth, it will be stopped
Amen.
In heaven. He was telling us what he's going to do when he was still on earth. Think about that. And then he says, whatsoever you release on earth, it shall be released in heaven. What does that mean? Because we always talk about the binding, but we don't talk about the loosing. I'll give you an example. I'm starting a new role. And I'm smart, but I'm smart enough to seek the God of the ages.
Amen.
Who knows everything. And a recent thing occurred to where I was asked to learn a software that I've never heard of before. I'm like, you know what, Pastor Tim, this is a job for Jesus.
Well,
because I wasn't going to stress about this. I'm like, you got me here this far.
Amen.
This is a job for Jesus. You know what I mean? Lord, I thank you that you have anointed me, and I thank you that you will release the wisdom of the ages.
Amen.
And I just started practicing. And as I started practicing, somebody in heaven looked down and said, I release unto you the wisdom of the ages. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Hallelujah. You ever wonder why you have the talents that you have?
Thank you, Jesus.
Because as you were seeking God, somebody in heaven released the gift to you.
Amen.
You ever wonder how did you get saved from that car accident? Because you released protection of the angels around you on the earth. That the chiefest high priest spoke to the angels around you and said, I release the angelic host to stop the car from getting damaged. Jesus, what are you doing? He's busy. Amen.
Amen.
Anybody get blessed?
Praise the Lord.
I get happy all by myself.
All right.
Jesus is busy. So let me show you a real life example, because I think this might become a mini series, Pastor Tim.
Go ahead.
Y'all ever wonder what Jesus is doing? You ever wonder, what does God think of terrorists? You ever wonder about that? I bet he wants to destroy them. Did you know that God loves terrorists?
Amen.
He don't like what they do. He loves their spirit because he can see what he can do with it. He's thinking, if you are so gung-ho in destroying a whole country, can you imagine what I could do with someone like you and turn it to for good? You could be an evangelist.
Amen.
You could be an apostle. So how many know that all of a sudden, when the disciples start doing what Jesus told them to do, they start going to the nations. Hi, look here. Start going to the nations, and they start preaching the gospel, right? All of a sudden, they got met with resistance. And all of a sudden, someone named Saul was breathing threats. He was the modern-day terrorist. He didn't care if you were a woman. He didn't care if you were a man. And he didn't care if you were a child. All he saw was, you're blaspheming God, and we're going to get rid of you. So how many know that when Jesus told the disciples, go into all the world, Saul was one of the ones he's talking about. If you read your Bible from Acts, the first chapter through ninth chapter, not one church person came knocking on Paul's door. Everybody stayed out of Saul's way. Did y'all notice that?
Amen.
Nobody came. Can you imagine that? You better not go to Saul's door and knock on the door and say, do you know Jesus? Do you know Jesus? Jesus will be your friend. You get locked up in jail somewhere. He might behead you.
That's right.
So nobody was willing to see the Saul. But how many know that this is a job for Jesus?
Amen.
Who can better witness to a terrorist than Jesus?
Amen.
What's Jesus doing? He's interested in the affairs of humanity. And I love what happened. If you look through the book of Acts, the ninth chapter, this is after Saul, actually this is after different Christians have gotten killed. One of the Christians that got killed was James, the brother of John, right?
Amen.
And there was a host of different persecution going on in Jerusalem. So then Saul's on his way now to Damascus. So I'm going to read to y'all Acts the ninth chapter. And Saul, yet breathing out threatenings. How many know that Jesus is not intimidated by terrorist threatenings?
Amen.
Don't be intimidated what you hear in the upcoming days, the upcoming months about more terror threats. Jesus already knows what the threats are.
Amen.
Oh, that's what I love about this. Not only is Jesus the high priest praying for the nations of the world, he's actively involved and giving us a strategy.
Amen.
How to overcome terrorism.
Amen.
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 He's trying to tell us you can't destroy terrorism by destroying human beings. You got to get to their heart.
Amen.
If you can ever get to the heart of the matter, things will change. Because the real terrorist is not human.
Amen.
It's the devil.
Amen.
Amen. I tell you, some of the terrorists that you'll find are KKK.
Amen.
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 Some of the terrorists are Black Panther. Some of them are even people who gaze and think they're Christians. No, true Christians are not terrorists.
Amen.
The real terrorist is the devil. He just uses titles, but it's all the same. Amen. So it says, Acts the 9th chapter. First verse, and Saul, yet breathing out threatenings and slaughter against the disciples of the Lord, went unto the high priest, the earthly high priest. Think about this. A terrorist, this terrorist was a religious terrorist. Y'all hear that? Saul was a religious
Amen.
Terrorist.
Amen.
He got orders from the high priest. Think about this. Who ever heard of a church person, a high priest, giving orders for you to lock away moms and dads from their kids? That lets you know you're not of God. Think about that. He desired of them letters to Damascus, to the synagogues, and if he found any of this way, whether they were men or women, he might bring them bound unto Jerusalem. And as he journeyed, he came near Damascus. Look at this. Saul got the orders to arrest the Christians of Damascus. Meanwhile, Jesus is in heaven. What's Jesus doing? What's Jesus doing? Apparently, there's a difference between Damascus and Jerusalem. I think the difference was somebody wasn't stopping on the earth. Everybody say
somebody
wasn't stopping on the earth.
On the earth.
Let me back up. Let me give you evidence of that. If you recall early in the book of Acts, James, the brother of John, got killed. There's no record of anybody in the church praying for him. But when they arrested Peter, all of a sudden the Bible says the church was praying, fasting, interceding, and an angel was dispatched to him. I tell you that the reason why the angel was dispatched was the church started praying. And if the church ever starts praying, Jesus, the high priest, will dispatch or release an angel to protect his people. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. So you fast forward, it seems like some people weren't praying like they should. Now, I'm not saying that every time you pray, it doesn't mean there's not always going to be some casualties.
That's right.
Amen? Because sometimes, even though you pray, there's going to be casualties.
Amen?
So I don't want to paint this picture that the reason why things happened was only because people didn't pray. Amen? Because sometimes it's in the will for casualties. Because think about it. I'll give you evidence of this. Stephen, the reason why Saul even got saved was of a casualty. As Stephen had not died, he wouldn't have been able to honor Jesus in his death. Amen? Because even that was a picture of what Jesus was doing. Stephen was dying for the cause of Christ. Sometimes people are dying for the cause of Christ. That's one of the greatest ways they can witness. And as he was being stoned to death, which is in the book of Acts, the 8th chapter, Saul was watching him. Saul and Stephen was preaching the gospel, just preaching his heart out, talking about Jesus, the God-man. And as he's witnessing, it looked like he had no help. No help whatsoever. And as he kept preaching and boldly proclaiming how good Jesus was, he said all of a sudden the heavens were opened. Did it not say that?
Amen.
The heavens were opened. And when the heavens were opened, this is the only time in the Bible that it shows, it says, in Jesus. He said, I see Jesus, the Son of God, standing on the right hand of the Father. What was Jesus doing? Jesus was getting so excited watching him releasing the gospel on the earth. Jesus stood up. And when he saw Jesus stand up, look what Stephen said. He said, I don't lay this sin to the charge of my accusers. Receive my spirit. And what I love about Jesus was, Stephen was asking, loose my spirit out of this body. And when he said that, Jesus received his spirit. And what is not recorded is when he received his spirit, I believe he didn't feel the pain.
Amen.
This is a testimony for those of you who are dying of cancer. Some ungodly church people are telling some people, the fact that you're dying of sin and you're a Christian, you didn't pray hard enough. Sometimes, some people who are believing God for their miracles, they just get tired. And even in their death, they haven't lost their faith. They say, I will still serve the Lord. Father, receive my spirit. And I believe with everything in me that when they pray that prayer, God calls them not to feel that pain. Because when Jesus died, not only did he die for our sins, our iniquities, it says that he was whooped. He bared our transgressions. And by his stripes, we are healed. One of the things he took was the sting of death. What does that mean is when others who don't know him, when they die of the same sickness that some Christians die of, that Christian may not feel the same effect that person feels because Jesus took the sting. Amen? So going back to when Saul was going to Damascus in the book of 9th chapter of Acts, as he journeyed, he came near Damascus, and suddenly there shined round about him light from heaven. And he fell to the earth, the 4th verse says, and a voice saying unto him, Saul, Saul, Why persecute you me? Let me back up and tell you how long ago this was. This is approximately 10 years after Jesus went to heaven. And Jesus was still concerned about the earth. He said, why are you persecuting me? Listen how Jesus is saying this. He says, fifth verse, who are you, Lord? Who are you, sir? And the Lord said, I am Jesus whom you persecute. It is hard to kick against the pricks. What does that mean? He's humbling Saul. He's comparing Saul to a horse. Pricks are these little things that when you kick against, the horse can't move. According to the rider, moves it around. Jesus is telling you, I'm riding on you.
All right now.
Glory to God. Hallelujah. That person who's coming against you, Jesus is about to show up. It's hard to kick against the prince. Why are you persecuting me? It may be about you, but it isn't about you. When the devil comes against you, he's not coming against you. He's coming against Jesus. Because the Bible did not say that we are the body of Christ.
Amen.
He's testifying in the heavens that I am the head of the church.
Amen.
And anytime you mess with my body, then you're messing with me.
Amen.
He's acting the way I would act if anyone attempts to contact my wife. Because she and I are one.
Amen.
That's how Jesus sees us.
Amen.
We are one with Jesus.
Amen.
When he sits on the right hand of the Father, we're sitting in the right hand of the Father. When you are walking down here as the head and not the tail, above and not beneath, he's walking as the head and not the tail.
Amen.
What am I saying? What is Jesus doing? He's doing whatever you allow him to do.
Amen.
And then Saul was trembling, astonished. He's like, how's a dead man who's been dead for 10 years talking to me? He said, he didn't even question. He said, Lord, what do you want me to do? Isn't that something?
Amen.
In a split second, he got saved.
Amen.
What you can't do for centuries, Jesus can do in a matter of seconds.
Amen.
The high priest came down and told him, it's hard to kick against the pricks.
Amen.
And the Lord said, arise and go into the city, and it shall be told to you what you must do. What I love about Jesus is, Jesus talks to us according to our personalities. He picked up real quick that Saul's used to giving orders. So in order for him to humble Saul, Jesus starts giving orders. Notice he didn't give him a lot of information. He said, get up, go to the city that you're trying to go to in the beginning, and there he'll be told to you what you're going to do. That's all you're going to tell him. And the light disappeared. Now, what's interesting about Jesus in the seventh verse, it says, the men which journeyed with him, Saul, they stood speechless, hearing a voice, but seeing no man. What's also interesting is, no one saw the light but Saul.
Amen.
Stop there. That's a revelation. Jesus was speaking to Saul, and the men were with him. Saul was the only one that saw the light. Jesus is bad. Why is it that Saul was the only one that saw the light and the others around Saul didn't see it? Because Jesus wasn't talking to them. Hey, glory to God. When Jesus ready to show up and get that unsaved person saved, he's going to shine a light just on that person. Jesus, the high priest, is going to visit the bars, y'all. He's going to visit the strip joints. And only that sinner that he's going to target is going to hear his voice. Only that sinner, because the Bible says, only my sheep hear my voice.
Yeah.
Glory to God. I'm getting happy, hope.
Hallelujah.
What's Jesus doing? He's saving.
Yeah.
He's healing.
Yeah.
He's delivering.
Hallelujah.
That's what Jesus is doing.
Yes.
That time when we were sinners, and we're trying to figure out how did we get in our right mind, because somebody was sitting on the right hand of the Father praying for you.
Thank you, Jesus.
How many know that nobody was praying for Saul?
Thank you,
Jesus. Nobody was praying for Saul. Not one person was on their knees. If anything, I pray, save us from Saul.
Amen.
So how many know if nobody's going to pray for you, Jesus is going to pray
Amen.
For you. If you heard nothing from me today, what's Jesus doing? He's praying for you.
Amen.
When you all of a sudden got faith and you didn't know where this faith came from, the book of John said that he will give you the faith of God.
Amen.
Because one of the gifts of the Spirit is faith.
Amen.
I'm not talking about the faith you get when you hear the word.
Amen.
Sometimes when the devil attacks you so hard, you're like, I don't know if I can handle this. And all of a sudden you get this strength out of nowhere.
Amen.
I can do this. Because Jesus, the high priest, has bequeathed unto you his
praise
own
him.
Faith.
Him.
What he did was he gave you a transfusion from his resurrected body. He said, I have all this faith. Who can I find in the earth to get this blood transfusion to? Oh, you want some faith over here? You're about to lose hope. All you got to do is release. Ask Father, release unto me your faith. And what's going to happen is he's going to do to you what he did for Peter. Where Peter's like, I don't have any more faith. Save me, Lord. He gave him some of his own faith to walk on the water. Whatever it is, Jesus, what is he doing? He's the high priest. I think, Pastor, it's going to be a mini-series. That's just too much to talk to you about. Everybody say, Jesus is too much. Glory to God. You can't talk about him in 50 minutes. He's too much. Glory to God. Glory to God, Lord. He's so bad it took 66 books to talk about him. And we still don't know everything about him. Everybody stand to your feet. Everybody get blessed. What's Jesus doing? Let me tell you one more thing he's doing. Jesus was so happy to just be involved in human beings' affairs. He showed up often in the Old Testament. One of the times we see him showing up was when Abraham and Sarah couldn't have a child. Three visitors showed up. The visitor in the middle was Jesus. There's another time you're going in the future, and Moses was looking at the burning bush. He said, who is this? He says, I'm the great I am. You go in the future, and Jesus said, you remember Moses said, I'm the great I am? I was the one in the burning bush. You go again in the future, and they're by the Red Sea. And it was like, what are we going to do? And all of a sudden, the Bible says, and the angel of the Lord came about them in the form of a fire. He was a fire by night. You remember that?
Amen.
And a cool by day.
Amen.
Who was this angel? That was Jesus.
Praise
you go fast forward again into the future in the book of Judges, and it talks about how all of a sudden the children of Israel, no, Joshua, excuse me, and all of a sudden the angel came by with a sword. And Joshua, so used to fighting, he said, who are you? Whose side are you on? Joshua's about to pull him through with a sword, and his angel looked at him and said, I'm not on your side, I'm on the Lord's side.
All right.
And let me give you orders. That was Jesus.
Amen.
He's always been interested in the affairs of humanity. Amen. We're going to talk more about this Jesus. What is he doing? Amen.
Amen.
Father, in the name of Jesus Christ, we love you and thank you so much for Jesus. Father, for those who don't know you who are tuning in right now, I want you all to pray this prayer. Say, Jesus, you are the Son of God.
You are the Son of God.
Thank you for praying for me.
Thank you for praying for me.
I accept you into my heart.
Forgive my sins.
In Jesus' name. And Father, I thank you that this Jesus that we preached about, he is real. And I thank you that he will manifest his glory like he's already done in each person's life. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
God bless you.